listening to this next day, you would have probably known there was a massive WhatsApp, Facebook and Instagram outage, which basically led everybody to go in to like apps like Snapchat and Twitter to get their social media rocks off, and generally just being bored with life in it. Because I think until these apps are sort of taken away from you momentarily, you'd forget how important they are to your kind of day-to-day, right, in terms of your content, your content absorption time or your content enjoyment time, whatever it may be. Especially if you're somebody who thinks you watch a lot of things, you don't usually watch a lot of things, you maybe check a lot of things on those platforms. So maybe it's a clip, an IGTV clip, whatever it may be. It might be somebody you're chatting to on WhatsApp and you're exchanging information, you're having just a catch up or whatever, or memes, doesn't matter. Facebook is all people arguing and whatever. Those are forms of content. But I think for whatever reason, we tend to like think content only happens like YouTube and like Netflix and all that sort of stuff, when it's not. Like, you spending all your time just going through your feed, or, you know, frantically, because I've seen people do it on the train, they have the Instagram up and they'll just be going through everyone's stories and they won't even be checking it. It's just like half a second, boom 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 boom, smashing it through. And of course, it might be something they like, they'll kind of go back to, but usually they're just tapping that thing from the right. You know how people would like power use Tinder and just be like, you know, swiping all the way one right and just hoping somebody matches? That's the same way people use Instagram stories and stuff. So it's not even as if like you're sitting down, you're absorbing it, but still, count up all the times that you're tapping through, count all the times you're in the discovery page. You're essentially watching a couple of episodes worth of a series every time you go to work, every time you're on a loo, every time you're just bored and in between things, every time you're at work and you're in between tasks. You're basically doing that on all those platforms. So when those platforms get taken away from you, you can just imagine the kind of gap that you have, the time gap that's available, the busyness gap, the boredom gap that you have now suddenly, where you're like, oh my God, I don't know what to do, and you're just stuck. And this is where I would always come back to people, because, you know, I'm an avid reader. I've kind of spent the entirety of my adult life reading. Even though I was a crappy student, I always kind of enjoyed the art of reading, or the love of reading. I kind of always had it in me. And there was a time period where I was reading like 4 to 5 books per month, and I'd post loads of stuff about it on social media. Then, of course, I kind of stopped doing it because I felt like it was like a little bit of a, you know, intellectual masturbation sort of thing. So I didn't want to do that anymore. But a lot of people used to always ask me, oh, how do you do it? And used to make it seem as if I was some sort of freak, that I was some sort of special talent, that I had some sort of God-given gift to read. And it's like, not really. I just carved out whatever time I was spending on those apps and just devoted it to just reading a bit. So what I would do is I'll just do like a minimum of an hour a day, and then whatever time I would be using on those apps, I'd also add on top. So if it's an hour a day, you're just sitting down on one sitting and doing it. Every time I'd go to a toilet, I'd take a book with me. Every time I'm on the bus, I'd have a book with me. So those little times you usually would be pulling out your phone, I'd just have a book. Don't get me wrong, it looked wanky seeing a dude like myself just standing at a bus stop reading a book. I know it does come across a little bit pretentious, but you could get through a lot of reading just doing that, because you're taking away all the time that you would have spent doodling on that, you know, twiddling around in your phone reading a book. Or sometimes I wouldn't read, I'll just be like, you know, meditating or thinking about the stuff that I read on the bus earlier, letting it kind of marinate in my head, maybe thinking through some ideas, maybe applying some of the principles to stuff that I've done in my life or things that I've gone through. And then little by little, you kind of absorb a lot more of the book too, because you're not just reading it to just steamroll through it and just prove that you read it. You're actually reading it for enjoyment. You're reading it to kind of get something out of it. But again, it's because your attention isn't taken away by other things, which also leads me to the thing to, you know, leads me to another point, which is the truth of the matter is, especially after this outage, I think most of us have realized, if you actually want to do great things in the world and you actually want to make a change and you actually want to become somebody of notoriety or smash whatever field that you're in or really excel in whatever career path you're doing, there needs to come to a point in your life where you just kind of realize that the people that you look up to who are really smashing it, they've probably, for the most part, been able to somehow put some kind of management tools or restrictions on their use of social media. That's the only way you get to those kind of positions. Of course, you have to avoid distractions outside of work. You can't be getting drunk and high every weekend. You can't be going to every social gathering. So you have to basically, any time you have that is not devoted maybe to your kind of close friends and family, you're going to have to pour all into your business, all into your vocation, your career, whatever it may be, your passion project. You're going to pour all of it in there, and then you might see some results. But for whatever reason, people think they can be posting on social media, they can be keeping up with all the gossip that's going on there, all the tea, you know, taking part in flipping comments and all that, and still thinking you can apply the same level of intensity and dedication to the stuff you're doing and still reach the levels of the people you maybe look up to. It just isn't going to happen. It really isn't. You need to have full attention on that. And unfortunately, these apps, the way they're created, they don't really play that kind of game. Do you know what I mean? They're not in the game of allowing you to have like to have time to do those kind of things. It's either you're on my app or you're nothing. Do you know what I mean? That's the issue that they have going on here. So what can you do? But anyway, this is courtesy of Sky News. It says WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram are coming back online. Of course, they all should be updated by now. Check mine and mine slowly but surely coming back. But it says Facebook and apps and services, including Instagram and WhatsApp, are coming back online after 6 hours of outage. That's one of the big reasons why people don't like monopolies as well, by the way. The fact that Facebook owns these two big behemoths of apps in terms of Instagram and WhatsApp, especially because WhatsApp has turned in basically to another social media platform with all their stories and shit. It's not good, right, in the long run, because effectively, if somebody ends up DDoSing Facebook, it's going to affect every other platform that they are also in part in cahoots with, do you know what I mean, or that they've bought. So effectively, your data is being passed through all three of these companies without your knowledge, without your consent, on a daily or sometimes on an hourly basis. Keep that in mind. The platforms crashed early Monday, with users unable to send or receive messages or refresh their news feeds. Facebook Chief Strategy Officer Mike Schroppen, what's how do you call that? Mike Schoff Shurop, it doesn't matter. Have blamed the outage on network issues, but just before midnight, they confirmed the Facebook service is coming back now. May take some time to get 100% to every very small and large businesses, family, and individual dependent on us. I'm sorry. Blah, blah, blah. Facebook engineering wrote on Twitter to the huge community of people and businesses around the world who helped us. We're sorry. Everyone's saying sorry today. We've been working hard to restore this access to our apps and services, and are happy to report that they're coming back online now. Thank you for bearing with us. That's a really good meme. That kid with the house on fire and Instagram and WhatsApp are the, what you call it, are the firemen. And it continues, it said, according to Down Detector, which collects status reports on services, 73,804 problems with WhatsApp were recorded in a spike at 4:35 p.m., which is, I guess, one of their main times people use it, right? Because it's just before everyone's heading off from work, heading out of college and whatnot. 43% of the WhatsApp problems were associated with the app, and 28% were related to sending messages. There were more than 58,219 reports of problems on Facebook, 71 regarding its website, and 17 on the app. Imagine all those mums and dads and aunties and shit are not on Facebook, not be able to argue in the evenings. They must have been livid, because they probably were in bed by now, so they must have been absolutely spinning, spitting feathers. More than 5% of reports were recorded in the peak problems with Instagram. Problems were reported across the world, including North and South America, Europe, Australia, Russia, and New Zealand. So I guess these are probably their biggest markets. That's why they're probably pointing them out. People using Facebook credentials to log into third-party apps such as Pokemon Go and Matchmasters were also said to be facing issues. Imagine setting up an account with Facebook to play Pokemon Go. Just set up and flipping email address with flipping Proton Mail or something. Like, you're giving these guys too much information, and then these are the same people that are also going to be worried about the vaccines. Like, you give these apps and these platforms so many data points about you and who you are as a person. They can literally replicate your behaviors without you even realizing they're doing it. And yet you don't want to get a little jab in your arm to be able to go to a flocking nightclub. It's like, I know both things are bad, but Jesus Christ, guys. Shares of Facebook, which are nearly 2 billion daily active users, closed to 4.9 lower on Monday. It comes as the company was also under pressure from testimony of whistleblower who claims it chose profit over safety. Security experts tracking the situation said the disruption could be a result of an internal mistake or the sabotage by an insider would be theoretically possible. People are alleging that this lady that came out, who I think has kind of come out with her name and who she is, who basically has told people everything they should know about how Facebook operates, about how they kind of enjoy the fact that people are so divisive and argue a lot on the platform because it obviously drives engagement. People are now saying that they're somehow tied together. The interview dropped in the same day that Facebook kind of went down. I don't really see how true that is, but it could be. Who knows? There's shady business out there in the social media landscape. Jonathan Zittrain, director of Harvard's Berkman, Klein Center for Internet and Society, described the situation by tweeting Facebook basically locked its keys in its car. Reuters news agency reported Facebook employees who are not identified as saying they believe the problems were caused by an internal routing mistake to an internet domain. This was compounded by the failures of internal communication tools and other services that depend on a domain to work. A similar issue was a free apps recorded in April 2019 when they crashed for about 2 hours. So I guess it's not in their best interest to say it was a DDoS attack, right? Because they don't want hackers to get the idea that they can DDoS attack such a large company like Facebook with all the security measures they have in place. So they're kind of coming out with this kind of internal domain issue kind of thing, saying, oh, internal apps were not working either. It was an internal issue. It wasn't anyone else outside. Because obviously if that happens and there's that kind of a security flaw or breach, that would, I guess, negatively affect their stock price, maybe negatively affect how people are kind of positioned in terms of their stock when it comes to Facebook and the other apps that they bought. So it's in their best interest to kind of obfuscate the truth, right? Half truths here and there, because they don't really owe anybody an explanation. They can do what the hell they want. And it is what it is. People keep moving on. But how depressing did you feel, or how depressed did you feel when you realized that your favorite apps had gone down and that you were left completely bored, and that if you came to a realization that, wow, these apps have a lot more power and a lot more influence and a lot more say in what I do day to day than I actually am led to believe. I think this is probably a great time for most people to probably start waning off of these apps in general. Again, I tend to kind of just use them as a place to kind of chat shit and hang out, whatever, but not necessarily as my only platform for entertainment. But I know some people don't, so everyone's different when they do stuff. But I don't know, man, there should be a way you should kind of withdraw yourself a little bit from these apps and not be so super dependent on them, especially since they share all your data between all three and every other person, maybe any other third party place as well that they get sold at to, because, you know, at the end of the day, data is king. And, you know, the more data that people have on you, especially these apps, the more money they're able to make, and people just seem to be willing to just give that shit away, innit? Like, what can you do?